and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Workers at the world's largest copper mine in Chile set to go on strike. NUMSA calls on workers to unite as wage talks hit deadlock in South Africa. US Labor Relations Board report says Amazon interfered with union elections. And for our final story, we look at the case against US drone program whistleblower Daniel Hale. In our first story, we go to Chile, where over 2,300 miners have announced a strike. Workers at the Escondida copper mine rejected the latest contract offered by its owners by 99.5%. In the vote held over the weekend, 2,164 workers approved the strike, while 11 voted against. Located in the Atacama Desert, Escondida is the world's largest copper mine, producing around 5% of all global supply. It is controlled by the Anglo-Australian BHP company, Rio Tinto, and the Japanese GECO Corporation and GECO2 Limited hold the remaining shares. The strike vote followed nearly 2 months of negotiations for an agreement. The workers are being represented by Union No. 1 at Escondida. In its last offer, the company had proposed a benefits payment of 18 million pesos. However, the union stated that the agreement would increase working time and operation demands and reduce breaks. It would also impact the protections given to sick workers. The contract also included a 1% pay rise, which fell way short of the 5% hike demanded by workers. They are asking to be compensated for working throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. According to a statement by the union, the mine's owners are set to earn $10 billion in revenue in 2021. It has demanded that 1% of the dividends given to investors distributed equally among all workers. Other demands include performance based on performance-based compensation, education for their children, and a better system for career development. Meanwhile, BHP approached the Labour Directorate in an effort to avoid work stoppage. Final negotiations will now take place for a mandatory 5 to 10 day period, after which the strike will begin. Escondida workers had previously held a 44-day strike in 2017. This led to $740 million in losses and contracted the Chilean GDP by 1.3%. In our next story, we look at the ongoing wage talks in South Africa's steel and engineering sector. The National Union of Metal Workers, or NUMSA, has rejected an offer made by the CSR. The federation had proposed a 4.4% increase across the board for the first year. This would be followed by a 0.5% increase in the second year and a 1% increase in the third. Meanwhile, NUMSA had sent a revised proposal of an 8% increase in the first year. This would be followed by a 2% per year increase with some flexibility. The union has stated that workers had signed a standstill agreement during the lockdowns in 2020. Despite this, they faced retrenchment during the pandemic. It has also rejected the special dispensation measure proposed by the employers association. This will introduce a new entry rate between 20 to 29 rand for employers not paying the minimum wage. NUMSA argues that this will essentially drive down wages in the industry. The union has now registered a dispute against the CFSA and other associations in the bargaining council. It has also asked workers to prepare for the mother of all strikes if employers refuse to settle the talks. Here is NUMSA General Secretary Irwin Jim to talk more about this issue.
Insofar as us as a union that takes care of the interest of workers, that in every round of negotiations we got a duty not only to take care of the workers but to engage employers and understand their concerns, and but also look on what is being presented on the table. The current offer on the table left us with no option but to reject it. We got our backs against the wall. There's no way that NUMSA can even think to consider what is on the table. I think, in essence, what employers are attempting to do in a very sneaky way is basically to continue to want to offer a 0% on increase this year. And maybe to sum it up, they just want another standstill agreement. We reject that. We're very firm that workers this year against the backdrop of many, many workers in the industry who have not received increases since 2014, with us in 2020 not having signed a standstill agreement, which was basically a wage freeze, employers must make a real offer in the first year. That's why we're putting 8% on the table. And we're saying we're flexible in the following year. We're giving them a very flexible position. And in our view, they should grab that, and there should be no need for us to end up in a strike, because we're saying they should offer CPI plus 2% improvement factor. If CPI plus 2% improvement factor we're putting on the table fall below 6%, they should give us 6%. If they feel that CPI is harsher for them, then they can reopen negotiations. So as a union, we're flexible for the following 2 years. But we're saying the first year, they must make an offer, because that will be crucial, and we are amenable, because it will ensure that we have a base that ensure that the following years are a bit better as the economy is recovering. And we are open to negotiations in the form of bilaterals to engage with employers to understand their situation. But we are not willing to take a blanket approach where we say to employers, you're not going to give an increase, you are going to have a new entry rates in the industry on the basis that you can't afford, when you have not opened up your books and disclosed. So genuinely, we're saying to employers, if they are honest and transparent, there's nothing that we, there are many ways of skinning the cat. United we stand, divided we fall, is about the fact that what any sector that is confronted with what we're confronted with. It is engineering today. It is going to be the auto sector tomorrow. We live in a community that have survived and lived any particular crisis at the back of standing together. When workers are on strike, it's important that the entire community must basically understand what are the demands, must understand that every worker work in that community, support 5 to 6 extended families, and if there are social activities, those who work make particular contribution to uplift the community, they are a source of assistance and support in whatever that happened in the community. We're simply making one point, that we cannot discuss solidarity at engineering with engineering workers only when engineering workers are on strike. All other sectors must begin to debate that, because if engineering end up indeed in a strike, workers in other sectors can embark on a strike in solidarity with those workers. It is engineering this year, it will be the motor, it will be the auto sector next year, and the motor sector. We need these sectors to begin to give support to each other, because we're facing a government that has adopted austerity measures. If you had a progressive government, it could announce that employers in any industry can't pay less than this particular national minimum wage, which must be a living wage, which must break with the apartheid past of super exploitation of black and African labor.
The US National Labor Relations Board has stated that Amazon interfered in a union election in Alabama. Over 3,200 out of the nearly 6,000 workers at the BHM1 warehouse cast their ballots in February and March. If the vote passed, they would have become members of the retail, wholesale and department store union. However, the action failed after 738 workers voted in favor while 1,798 voted against. Hundreds of ballots were left uncounted after Amazon raised objections during the counting process. The RWDSU then filed appeal citing anti-union propaganda and surveillance of ballot boxes by Amazon. Workers had received brochures and text messages instructing them to vote no. Reports claimed that Amazon had also worked with local officials to change the timings of traffic lights outside the warehouse. Red stop lights would have given organizers no time to vote. The main issue raised by RWDSU was the placement of ballot boxes by local postal services. A mailbox was installed right outside the exit gates of the warehouse. The union stated that this gave the impression that Amazon would be involved in counting the ballots. The NLRB report found that this on-site placement was a unilateral decision of Amazon. It argues that this destroyed the laboratory conditions necessary for the election. The board's hearing officer has recommended that the results be voided and a fresh election be held. The findings have now been sent to the regional NLRB director, who will issue a final ruling. Continuing with the US for a final story, we look at the case of drone warfare whistleblower Daniel Hale. He has been sentenced to 45 months in prison after pleading guilty to one charge under the Espionage Act. Hale is a former US intelligence officer who was deployed to Afghanistan's Bagram Air Base. He later worked for a defense contractor, which is when he leaked 17 documents to the press. These documents showed that 90% of the people killed during a drone operation were unintended targets. They also showed how the US government placed people on watch lists. Over 40% of people in the database of suspects had no recognized terrorist group affiliation. Here is a video feature on his case. Over a 5-month period in 2012, US aerial strikes killed 155 people in Afghanistan. Of these, only 19 were intended targets. 136 were bystanders. They were labeled as enemies killed in action just because they were near the target. This means 90% of the victims of those drone strikes were not the intended targets. They were likely civilians. This information became public when Daniel Hale released 17 intelligence documents. 11 of those were marked secret and top secret. The documents also revealed that over 40% of the people labeled terror suspects by the US government had no clear affiliations with terror groups, and that the US government targeted US citizens as well in Afghanistan and other countries. Daniel Hale is a US Air Force veteran and former intelligence analyst. During his military service, he participated in the US drone program at Afghanistan's Bagram Air Base. In 2019, he was arrested and charged with the Espionage Act and theft of government property. In March this year, Hale pleaded guilty to one count of the Espionage Act, admitting that he leaked confidential documents in 2015. He has now been sentenced to 45 months in prison by a federal judge. At his sentencing, Hale said, "I'm here because I stole something that was never mine to take, precious human life. I couldn't keep living in a world in which people pretended that things weren't happening, that were. Please, Your Honor, forgive me for taking papers instead of human lives." Hale is the first prominent whistleblower to be handed a jail sentence under the Espionage Act since President Joe Biden took office. Documents released by Hale have brought to light the crimes committed by the US through its drone warfare. Then-President Barack Obama had stated in 2014 that there had to be near certainty of no civilian casualties for a drone strike to be carried out. Hale, who provided intelligence for some of these strikes during his service, saw the operations to be quite different. Ahead of his sentencing, Hale's lawyers submitted an 11-page letter written by him in jail to the judge. Hale wrote, "Not a day goes by that I don't question the justification for my actions." He said that the strikes may have been permissible by the rules of engagement, but he did not believe that they were in any way necessary for the protection of the United States of America. He also argued that the war in Afghanistan had very little to do with preventing terror from coming into the US and a lot more to do with protecting the profits of weapons manufacturers and so-called defense contractors. Hale was indicted in 2019 around the same time as Julian Assange. He is among the 8 people who have been criminally prosecuted for leaking documents to the media under Donald Trump's administration. He was the 5th to be charged with the Espionage Act. His indictment and conviction have been sharply criticized by activists, anti-war groups, and rights organizations. Code Pink organized a demonstration outside the courthouse where the sentencing took place. They stated, "Hale had exposed the US government's criminal drone murder of innocent children and received a 45-month prison sentence." Edward Snowden called Hale one of the great American whistleblowers. The American Civil Liberties Union said, "Leaks to press in the public interest should not be prosecuted under the Espionage Act." Daniel Hale helped the public learn about a lethal program that should never have been kept secret. He should be thanked, not sentenced as a spy. And that's all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.